Please, Jehovah, make the Torah's words sweet in my mouth, and in the mouth of all your people, the house of Israel. May we, your children, all of Israel, know your name and the name of your Messiah, Yeshua. And may we study your Torah simply because it is good. Blessed are you, Jehovah, who gave us the Torah of truth. Blessed are you, Jehovah, our God, King of the universe, who sanctified us with your commandments and commanded us concerning the counting of the Omer. Today is 2 days of, is it 2 days? 2 days at sunset. Okay, thank you. 2 days of the Omer. Baruch atah Adonai, Baruch atah Yehovah Eloheinu melech ha'olam asher kishanu b'mitzvotav v'ciuvanu a safarat ha'omer. Amen. So don't forget, you're supposed to be counting. So at sundown, it will be two. It's not quite sundown, but it's okay. I see light. Well, we're talking about the Torah study, the gifts of the Ruach, the gifts of wisdom, and the gifts of knowledge. I already asked you if you needed wisdom and if you needed knowledge. We're going to look, you need them all, I need them all at one time. When we look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8, always keep it in mind about who he's talking to, why is he talking to them, what is going on. Always keep in mind about the Corinthian people and the cult of Aphrodite and the logos and the aeons and the demonic activity that's trying to speak. You know, we have even people today who pretend they speak to the dead by God and know this and know that. And we all know that's demonic because Jehovah told us not to mess with that, right? And even though it might seem to be right on occasion or maybe a lot of occasions, it doesn't mean it's from Jehovah, right? So when we look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8, it says, to one through the Spirit is given a word of wisdom, to another a word of knowledge. And then again, remember who he's talking to, in accordance with the what? Same Spirit. So he's talking about, make sure you understand, there's not multiple spirits, there's not multiple gods, correct? Same Spirit. To the one through the Spirit is given a word of wisdom. To another one is given a word of knowledge, and according to that same Spirit. So just to repeat myself, Paul continues to emphasize that all the gifts are from the one and same Spirit, the Ruach. It is also noteworthy that the operation of the first two gifts and the last two gifts involve the proper use of words. And how many know that sometimes we have problems with words? So the first two have to do with words, and the last two have to do with words also. Paul begins his first letter to the Corinthians by spending what may seem an inordinate amount of time on the wisdom of Jehovah. Sometimes he speaks through those gifts, and sometimes he spends more time on those gifts. And so as he spent time in kind of creating a scenario up to understanding wisdom, the reason is because it's important that we have the foundation before we really jump into all those gifts. You know, there's most New Testament theologians and historians agree that Paul's first letter to the Corinthians contains all of his most controversial teachings in one letter. Paul has been misunderstood. The reason why he's misunderstood is because there is a fallacy that thinks that Paul had this conversion and that he was one thing and he was Jewish and then he becomes a Christian and he changed his name and, you know, from Saul Paul. But we all know that that's not true, that actually he used one of those names in his Greek world and one of those names in his Hebraic world. And so it wasn't a change, it wasn't a conversion. Any Jewish person that comes to know the Messiah does not convert, they just become complete. They come to the place of understanding that their Messiah all along, I'm talking about a religious Jew who understands that they serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, so they're not converting to anything because the Word of God is what they follow. They're just becoming complete in understanding that the Messiah has arrived and then the Messiah is for them. So a lot of times we mistake ourselves by going out, you know, we need to convert you. You do need to convert the people of the world because the people of the world don't serve God, right? So there is a difference in how you approach. But before diving into, and if you look at his book in the Corinthians, in both books, 1 and 2, or both letters, you realize that he talks, he deals with fornication. He deals with legal matters between saints, right? Arguments. If you have an argument with someone, bring someone. If they don't listen, bring two. If they don't listen, bring the congregation. If they don't listen, get rid of them. He deals a lot about marriage and what marriage is and how you deal with that in marriage as husband and wife. He deals about sacrificing to idols. He deals with and talks about Yeshua's last meal. We brought that up in the Passover, that he's telling you that any person from the world can come in, but when it becomes to the Passover Seder, you should not allow just anyone to sit at that table, because that table that we ate from on Monday and also Tuesday is his table. And you don't invite and eat bread with demons. He also talks about clean and unclean food, head coverings, which can be controversial sometimes. People, get all crazy about head coverings. Circumcision. He talks about the law. He talks about the gifts of the Spirit. And he places this heavy emphasis then on wisdom. And the reason is because when you deal with all those situations, what are you going to need? You're going to need wisdom, right? When you're dealing with all those situations, and now this is not just multiple churches. He's dealing with this in this one body. That's a lot. You know what I'm saying? So it seems that Paul, through the Ruach, is already aware of the tendency to approach all these issues through knowledge, natural knowledge, through much study, through Google searches, right? Rather than through seeking the wisdom of Yehovah, because sometimes, as modern as we are, we seek the opposite way. We should be seeking him and his word. What do you say? What does this mean? Reveal something to me. But we're just going to go to Google. And then whatever we see in Google, and I'm not coming against Google, because Google's been good when it comes to being able to go look at this and this word and that word. But if your whole reality is that if I study to gain from man instead of studying to gain from Yehovah, it can be very quite confusing, because you will find many multiple opinions about everything, correct? So the first two gifts involve the mind and or the condition of the mind, because wisdom and knowledge has to do with the mind, correct? And so he's going to deal with that mind or that condition of the mind. And the mind is the arena where the battle with the adversary is fought. You need to get that. On the step as we go toward the gifts of the Spirit, you need to realize that the fight that you have is with your mind. The heart of man is where one receives the word or the seed of Elohim when one comes to know the Father. So who took care of your heart? He did. Who takes care of your mind? You do. And the problem is that we are appreciative that he took care of our heart, but we don't take care of our mind. And when we don't take care of our mind, it can lead our heart astray. So realize that you could not do anything about your heart. He had to come. He had to pour himself out on this Passover. We know tonight would be that he's on the cross. And so he's hanging there in symbolism. As if you look back tonight, he would be hanging there and he would be suffering for you. Okay? And so he's doing that so that your heart could be changed. But the mind is the arena. And this is what Paul was talking about. He's trying to get them to understand some things about the mind. We are warned in the Torah about mixing seed. We can get a little crazy sometimes, there's always an understanding about, wool and something synthetic or what is it, wool and linen mixing and so on and so forth. There's a natural understanding for it, but there's also a spiritual understanding for it. And so he's trying to get us all the time, whether it's clean or unclean food or whatever, he's trying to get our minds straight that we just do what he wants us to do and don't do what we want. And it takes every day of our lives and illustrations every day of our lives. So if you go and you have a choice between beef and, a pig, there's an understanding. What does he want? They're both delicious. Hello? Don't sit there like, no, nah, nah. They were both good. You ate a lot. But he's not talking about both being good. And even whether one is good for you and one is bad for you, he's not even talking about that when it comes to your... He's saying whether good or bad for you, the point is if he said eat it and then don't eat it, that's the point. Right? We're trying to figure out, well, it's better for us today because of our cleanness and how we... It has nothing to do with that. If he said eat this, then eat it. If he said don't eat it, then don't eat it. And it's really about mixing things. So that's why he's telling us, even in the church, you can't have fornication and then righteousness. You can't say you love your brother and then fight with your brother. You can't have that you've received his forgiveness and then have unforgiveness in your heart. That's mixing the seed. You can't mix the seed. You either have to have the seed of him, and if you have the seed of him, then you have forgiveness. If you have the seed of him, then you're being it to him. If you have a seed of him, you're following him, and you can't mix that seed. And we're really good at mixing seed. So here is Paul talking to the Corinthian people. And remember, they are in the middle of a city that has the cult of Aphrodite, where knowledge, natural knowledge and natural wisdom is pushed. And so what he's trying to warn them about is this: don't bring natural wisdom in with my wisdom. That's mixing seed. You can't sit back and say, well, my opinion is, as soon as you say your opinion is, you're in trouble. Because you're mixing seed. What you should always say is, let me see what the Father says, and then if I am wrong, I will adjust myself. I'm not asking the Father to adjust me. He's not adjusting because he has not come to abolish anything. I have to adjust myself. But when I come with my thinking and my heart and what I feel, and then I go through the centuries and I come up and I figure different society than that society, and they are in a desert and we're here and they didn't have refrigeration and we do, you're getting in trouble because you're mixing seed. And he warns us about mixing seed. So when one is born again, how many are born again? When one is born again, the seed, remember, of our Heavenly Father is sown in our hearts, correct? You're born again, that seed now is placed within your heart, and from that point forward, our minds have a new source of information to signal our bodies. If this is truly in your heart, then all of a sudden I get new signals, right? And the new signals say, oh, that's wrong, that's right, eat this, don't eat that, do this, don't do this, say this, don't say that, love that, hate this, because I get new signals, right? And the more that I read, the more that I study, and we know how the brain works, the more different avenues start to grow in my brain, and then all of a sudden some of those old things that I no longer think about anymore, they die. Because if you don't use those roads, if you want to say, in your brain, they'll die. They'll go away because they only thrive when you give it information. So if you stop feeding that and start feeding something new, something else will grow. And so he's telling us, and he's telling them, because if he's telling them, he's telling us, don't mix the seed. And know that this new seed that you have in you is a new source of information to signal your body. I'm not the new signal. Your husband, your wife's not the new signal, because we can all get messed up. Because if you want to do something that's against Adonai and I want to join you, then we'll agree with each other. So we're not good sources. If I said to you, oh, Sister So-and-so got on my nerves. I just hate when, don't you? Yes. Because I went to a source that was going to what? Agree with me. I'm not going to go to a source that loves and adores them, and I can say, don't they get on your nerves? No, why would you say that? Well, I don't want to talk to you now. Because then we throw, you think you're so righteous. We just messed up. We were looking for someone to agree with us. So we were trying to mix seed, and it's not going to happen. So the adversary knows this. How many know he's smart, but he's not God? Correct? And he knows this. And so he sets up shop where? In your heart? No. He sets up shop in the arena of your thoughts and mind. And then we have to do something. When he sets up shop, we have to shut it down. How many know the only way that a shop survives is if people go and buy? So if he sets up shop in your brain, in your mind, and with doubt and unbelief and hatred and all those things, and you never buy anything from it, he's going to move his shop, right? Because he wants you to get to a place where you exalt him above God. And if you never exalt him above God, he really wants that. He's wanted that from the very beginning. He's not going to stay with you. He wants to find a location where he will be a God. Okay? Which is why we have 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 6. For although we do live in the world, we do not wage war in the worldly way, because the weapons we use to wage war are what? Not worldly. On the contrary, they have Jehovah's power for doing what? Demolishing. Everyone say that word. Demolishing. You know what demolishing means? Total destruction. It has the power to have total destruction over what? Strongholds. Jehovah changed your heart, but you still have strongholds in your brain. Correct? And the power, or the word of God, has the power to bring those down. We demolish arguments and every arrogance. Who are we arguing with? Ourselves. We're trying to tell ourselves, well, this is okay, and God don't mind, and we're under grace, and you're never winning the argument. And every arrogance that raises itself against the knowledge of God. Do you see that? You need to underline that. You need to get that, because anytime we say that we can do contrary to this, that's arrogance. Whenever we say we know better than he does, that's arrogance. Listen, children got slapped for less than that. If your child came and you said, listen, you don't know anything, that's fighting words when you're a parent, right? Every arrogance that raises itself up against the knowledge of God, we take every what? Thought captive, and then we do what with it? We make it obey the Messiah. As we would tell our children, you will go clean that room, and you'll go clean it now, even if I have to watch over you. With this stick, you will clean it. You will be obedient to me. You will not act that way. You will not be that way, right? Because what do we say? Because I ain't raising no hellion. Well, I'm sure the father's up here said, I'm not raising no hellion. And if I have to, I'll bring you every MBO, every PGP, every testing, every trial, every pit, everything I can throw at you, because I would rather you lose your arm, lose your eye, lose your ear, and save your soul. Until you get it, that you bring every thought captive and make it obey the Messiah. And when you have become completely obedient, then we will be ready to punish every act of disobedience. So the enemy has already been cast out of a believer's circumcised heart. He has no place in your heart. He has no place in your heart. Where was he kicked out of heaven? He was kicked out of the throne. He was one of the archangels, right? He was around the throne. Where was he kicked out? From the throne. From the very heart. Righteousness and unrighteousness cannot be there. So Yehovah had to send Yeshua himself wrapped in flesh in order to change your heart and come in your heart. But then your mind, because you are a people of choice, right? You have a choice to accept him, but you don't have a choice to be able to change your heart. He has to do that. But once you accept him, you have the ability now to choose every thought that comes your way. And I'm sure you've all had bad thoughts. I'll raise my hand with you. Right? That's not to get to see who did it, because we all do it. And I've also had that struggle with my heart, with my thoughts, saying, have you ever had a thought and then tell your thought you shouldn't think that way? And the more you say you shouldn't think that way, the more it starts to come, and you have to then replace it. Have you ever had to just start singing or praising or doing something to get that thought out? Because the more you challenge that thought, the more it came against you. So it's not just the challenge of it. It's changing it, because it will come. You have received all the word within you, which makes you a child of Yehovah. I want you to get that point. I want you to get the point that when the Father comes and changes your heart, he's planted a seed. This is the seed. Which means in you is all the word. So look at it this way. You just have to surrender to the word that's already in you. The Ruach is there to reveal that word to you. So you're not handicapped in that you're trying to gain it. It's already been there, just waiting to produce. Just waiting to produce. But there is something that's trying to stop it. and that is the enemy who's picked up and placed a great big mall in your brain. Not just a shop, but a mall. And trying to stop you from really being what Yahweh wants you to be. So now, walking out our new creation becomes a matter of growth and maturity. That's all. Say growth and maturity. That's just the key, people, right there. You want to grow and you want to grow up. That's it. Every child that's been born from a mother has the ability within them to live an independent, successful life. Right? What stops them? Their brain, their thinking processes. And what do? You try to get them to stop thinking that way and think the way that God wants them to think, because you know that they can succeed and have great things, but their brain is stopping them. It is not a coincidence that Paul begins with the arena of the mind first, for our minds are not the mind of the Messiah. And because of that, the other gifts cannot function in a godly manner. So until you get the mind under control, allowing even that wisdom to flow, none of those gifts will operate correctly or godly. I didn't say they wouldn't operate. I said they won't operate godly. Maturity is what really brings you to a place of honing in your skills. Even people who have skills, or you finish college, all of you who are professionals who finish college and have this degree, you know now that you're basically better now than you were when you began. You were maybe more enthusiastic in the beginning, but you certainly have more wisdom now. Right? You have more wisdom now. Now, you know, and that wisdom means not to burn yourself out, because you say, but now you're like, well, let me think about this whole thing. So we want to function in a godly way. If you have the gift of tongues, you want to do it in a godly way. If you have interpretation, you want to do it in a godly way. If you have wisdom or knowledge, you want to do it in a godly way. If you have discernment, you want to do it in a godly way. Healing, you want to do it in a godly way. You want it to be functioning in a godly way. So when we look at the word of wisdom and the word of knowledge, there are no definite articles here in the Greek. And that really signals to us that godly wisdom and knowledge are useless if they are not spoken. What good is it to have wisdom and knowledge if you're not speaking it? So let's look at wisdom again. We looked at it a little bit. Wisdom in Greek is Sophia, right? And in the Hebrew, it's a chokmah, okay? One's in Greek, one's in Hebrew. What we did understand, if you have those real quick, is that, and we talked about it a week ago, maybe 2 weeks ago, Sophia, in its oldest form, is used to describe that which lacks genuineness, but also the deceitfulness of the intellectual elite. Your brain and your knowledge, your wisdom, man-made, natural, will deceive you. You think too highly than you ought to think. You think you know more than what you actually know. And we'll throw it around. Well, in my years of study, okay. Your years of study of what? Google? Your years of study of what? Someone else telling you? Books that you've read? You don't think they read books also? So it depends on what source. And we all have read books, and there's some books you like, because the information is agreeable to you, and there's some books you set aside and said, heresy! It's all because you don't agree with it, right? So Sophia, in its oldest form, lacks genuineness and has deceitfulness. So if you are one of these people who walk in it, then you are a Sophist, and that is, and if you're a teacher, don't get upset. It means that you're a professional teacher, a worldly, vain reasoner that's been trained by the system. This is why we have to be careful where our children go to college. I didn't get no amen, but that's okay. We have to be careful, because what they're doing is they're training our children by the system, according to the system. And whatever system it is, that's what they'll be trained. If they go to a Christian college, and it's still traditionally contemporary, but traditional, they'll be taught that according to the system. If you go to a Baptist college, what are you going to be taught? Baptist stuff. If you go to Pentecostal college, what are you going to be taught? Pentecostal stuff. If you go to a worldly college, what are you going to be taught? Worldly stuff, humanistic stuff. You're going to be taught according to the system. The whole point of it is to professionally train them according to the system, that they would be a reasoner according to the system, which means the object was not for a person to come to a sound, logical conclusion to a matter, but rather to win the argument. They're not teaching them to have good sense and to argue back and forth. They want you to learn what they're going to teach you so that you will always win the argument. Again, I'm not dogging anyone, but call a Jehovah's Witness to your house. Call a Mormon to your house. What are they trained to do? Win the argument. Grab their hand and say, let's pray, and start praying in the Spirit. They'll run out of your house as quickly as anything. They're not used to that. They don't understand that. Use some scripture that they have not been taught to combat. They'll be confused. Sad thing is, so we. When they use scripture that we have no idea what they're talking about. My point being, they are trained to be a reasoner of the system, and they're only trained to win the argument. Because if they weren't trained just to win the argument and to have debate, then they wouldn't be so dogmatic a lot of times in this conversation that we're having. So we look at wisdom, chokmah, which means knowledge accumulated through experience. Knowledge accumulated through experience. So a 15-year-old, 20-year-old, do they have more knowledge than a 50-year-old? No, not really. You know, there's something about respect for those who have lived a life. They have some experience, correct? Even if they're still wacky, they still have some experience of how to continue to be wacky throughout all those years. Fundamentally, wisdom is the proper experimental use of knowledge. It's the ability to use that knowledge in a way that you are going to then prosper or be better in your life. So we have this knowledge that is through experience. This wisdom is how you're using that knowledge in your life. The first occurrence in its natural use, because remember, to understand it, we have to go back to the beginning, to the Torah, because the five books of the Bible, the first five books of the Bible, are the foundation. They are Noah's Webster's dictionary for all the other words that we find in the prophets and the writings and the gospels and the epistles, because it is the foundation. Genesis chapter 41, verse 8 says what? In the morning, he found himself so upset that he summoned all the magicians of Egypt and all its what? Wise men. Pharaoh told them his dreams, but no one there could interpret them for him. Wise men. Okay? They had some experience through time. They had knowledge through this experience. They're just not someone who just came off the boat. They're not someone who is just born. Someone who has been with Pharaoh, seen Pharaoh, been around the block. That's why you're going to call wise men. Right? If I have some deep, dark secret I'm trying to unfold, I'm really not going to the children's class and asking, what do y'all think? You call upon the elders, right? Because the elders are supposed to have maturity. They're supposed to have wisdom. In Genesis 41, 38 and 39, Pharaoh said to his officials, can we find anyone else like him? The spirit of Yehovah lives in him, talking about Joseph. So Pharaoh said to Joseph, or Yosef, since Yehovah has shown you all this, there is no one as what? Discerning and wise as you are. So this happens, this second occurrence happens when Yehovah gifts Joseph to be able to interpret the dreams. So what do we see then in Genesis 41? We already see the Ruach moving on someone's life, because Joseph, as a young man, doesn't have that experience enough. But what does he have? The Ruach in his life, right? So natural wisdom is not something to be learned in books. It is interwoven with the experience of life. You can read a book, you can read the whole library, but until you have experience, those books that you read don't come alive, right? I didn't say you didn't have wisdom. I didn't say that knowledge is not something to be learned in books. I said wisdom is not something to be learned in books, because you can gain knowledge. How many of us have read this book and we still lack wisdom of how to apply it in our lives, correct? But you can say, what does it say about this? And who, when do they do this? And who stood there? And we can know it and we can say it. We have memorized it. 1 Corinthians 13, we probably memorize the love chapter, right? And how many still have a hard time with the love chapter? One of its closest cognates is a gom, or a pool of water, i.e. a place where things collect over time. So when you see this natural wisdom, a cognate is a gom, which is a pool of water. That means over a period of time, water gathers. Over a period of time, knowledge comes and wisdom. So you can see it's one of those things I talked about, the root, the parent root, right? The natural use helps us to understand the idea of wisdom in the abstract. So let's look at Isaiah 41:18. I will open up rivers on the barren hills, wells down in the broad valleys. I will turn the desert into a lake and dry ground into springs. Take Isaiah 41:18 and apply it to what you just learned. What's Isaiah 41 talking about? Natural or spiritual? Yes. He will do that naturally, but when he says, I will open up rivers on barren hills, that means wisdom and knowledge will be coming to you when you don't have it. You know what that's saying? This is a gift. I will open up rivers on barren hills, which means you don't have the knowledge nor the experience in order for that information to be yours. But guess what? By the power of the gift of wisdom, I will cause rivers to come on those barren hills. I will cause wells down in the broad valleys to come up. I will turn the desert into a lake and dry ground to springs. That's hope for us. How many have ever felt like a dry ground, barren place, desert? I have no idea what I'm doing. I have no idea what's going on. What do? We sometimes seek natural wisdom. But what we really should be doing is seeking His wisdom. Wisdom in Hebrew thought, remember Hebrew thought, not Greek thought, is a truth that is born from two witnesses, knowledge and observance and adventures of life. Wisdom in Hebrew thought is a truth that is born from two witnesses, knowledge and observance and adventures of life. This is why as we began to study Torah and we did some shifting and so on and so forth, that was a natural progression, because life experience, we start learning some things, we get knowledge, we start observing those things, and it starts this new adventure of our life. That's wisdom. Wisdom is not to learn something and not change it. You. To know this doesn't work, but Yahweh says it does it this way, but we're going to ignore that. That's not wisdom. Right? That's downright dumb. And we've even said it to our children, why do you keep on doing the same thing? Why do you keep doing the same thing? We're trying to be nice, right? So we don't want to say you're dumb, but we're saying try something different. This is not working. Every time I do this, it's not working. Well, then guess what? Don't do that. Do something different. Listen, if you're sitting in that seat, and you're saying, I think I'm getting stale and chair, well, then move around. Do something different. Maybe that seat has something stale on it. Do something different. Gain the wisdom of, Yehovah. Come to the altar. Lay your face at the altar. Do something. Remember, there is a manifestation gift and not a collection of man's knowledge and wisdom. So we know that chokmah is knowledge with life experience, correct? But we're talking about natural. So that means when we talk about a supernatural gift, this is where it gets really powerful. A supernatural gift is not a collection of man's knowledge and wisdom. It is a supernatural gifting of knowledge and life experience supernaturally given by the Spirit as He wills, which means you can have the gift of wisdom come out of you And that means the reason why it's supernatural is because you do not have the knowledge or the experience to deal with it, but it's coming. That's how you know it's supernatural. You haven't read a book about it, and you haven't lived long enough to even experience it, but something's flowing out of you, and because it's flowing out of you, then guess what that is? That is the gift of wisdom or the gift of knowledge. It is the ability to make a judgment, a decision, or counsel based upon something you did not learn yourself. Otherwise, you are back to the Sophias, natural wisdom, natural books. This is something you don't even know. It's something you have no understanding about. You have no experience on it. it's out of your league, but now all of a sudden you're flowing with something. I remember a long time ago when I was a little boy, and my mother and father were not living for Yehovah, and I came home from school, and I can't even remember the age, but I know I was little. And I came to the door, and my mother comes over with her friend and asks me a question. I can't remember the question. But as soon as she asked me the question, I said, by faith. And they looked at me like I was Moses on the mountain. And I walked away, and they were like, to me, I wasn't expecting, didn't have enough experience, you know what I'm saying? Didn't have any really knowledge because I'm a child. And at that moment, the Ruach gave me a word, which was the word they needed to hear, and I didn't even get it. I was just like, by faith, and walked on like, I'm doing my homework. Leave me alone. And I remember that, and I remember it because it was just so out of the ordinary. It wasn't something, you know, I didn't go in and say, well, let me go pray. Let me go seek, you know, Adonai. Let me, you know, hold on. Okay, the word is. It just came, and it satisfied them. I mean, it truly satisfied. And what I found out a little bit later was that the friend of my mother was having a problem with something, and they had been talking all afternoon, and they just needed answers, and my mother didn't have the answer, and I came in one word and solved and gave peace and went to my room. Again, it wasn't like I got to the room and was like, oh, the Lord had used me. It was just a flow. So the ability to make a judgment or decision or counsel when you don't have the experience behind you or even the knowledge of anything, that's when the gift, supernatural gift, the manifestation gift starts to work. The gift of wisdom is the supernatural ability to make a life experience judgment having not yet had the life experience. That's what makes it supernatural. Now, all these supernatural manifestation gifts were in Yeshua. When there was wisdom needed, he gave it. When there was knowledge needed, he was there. All of them were there. Even tongues and interpretation of tongues. Even though we isolate it as something new. It's not. He is the tongues. He is the one who interprets those tongues. You know, as I'm reading and studying, I'm reading and going back to the rabbis and thinking some things, especially with the gift of tongues, because the gift of tongues can be a little crazy. How many know this, and this is off track, but I'll just give you a little food. How many know the fiddler on the roof? And what's that song, famous song he says? If I were a rich man, then what's the next words? Right. And we think he must not have known what to say, so he just said, did a little. That traces back to the understanding of what tongues is, because tongues is an explanation of rejoicing that comes out on a natural, ununderstandable. And so it even hooks back that as he was doing it, he had such joy and such excitement that it just did it, and he just started speaking. It's interesting, isn't it? So now when you watch that movie, you'll be like, he's speaking in tongues. No, please don't do that. Please don't do that. I'm just telling you, when you go back to the Hebrew words and understand it, it connects it. It connects it. And so it wasn't an odd thing. You know, the odd thing at Acts was not that they were speaking in tongues, but they were acting like they were drunk. That was the odd thing, okay? So anyway, that was just an extra little oof. We'll have that probably in about 6 weeks. All of these supernatural manifestation gifts were in Yeshua, and now we are in him. So remember, let's go back to the seed. A seed has to produce like kind. So if he has all these, and now he is in us, that means they are in us, waiting to be used, because he's the seed, and the seed is in us, and that seed must produce, and it must produce what he is, and he is wisdom, and he is knowledge, and he is discernment, and he is this, all those, it's in us. So according to the spiritual laws, because spiritual laws don't lie like natural laws, right? An orange tree produces apples, right? No. It has to produce oranges. So according to the life spiritual laws set in place in the beginning, these gifts can only be manifested after we are immersed in the Messiah by grace through faith, because it's attached to the seed. So until you have the seed in you, it cannot produce. He is the one in whom all gifts and treasures are hidden, which is why Paul places such a heavy emphasis on being in the Messiah. Look at Colossians chapter 2, 2 and 3. My purpose is that they may be encouraged, that they may be joined together in love, and that they may have all the riches derived from being assured of understanding and fully what? Knowing God's secret truth, which is the Messiah. It is in him that all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are hidden. You can't bypass the Messiah and get wisdom and knowledge. Your college is not going to give it to you. They're going to give you Sophias. They're going to give you Sophia knowledge. They're going to give you book knowledge, right? And only through experience will you have even more of that book knowledge. But only the hidden treasures of wisdom and knowledge are in the Messiah. So therefore, you must find the Messiah. You must be in the Messiah to have that wisdom and knowledge. You may read it here, but you'll not find the hidden treasures of wisdom and knowledge, because you have to be in him for him to reveal it to you, right? Isn't that what Colossians 2 through 3 says? Look at 1 Corinthians 1:24. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, this same Messiah is Yehovah's power and Yehovah's wisdom. Who is? The same Messiah. And we know who the Messiah is. Who is the Messiah? Yeshua. But who is the Messiah? Yehovah in humanity wrapped. That's why he has that wisdom. That's why he's not come to abolish himself. He cannot abolish the word or the Torah, because to do that would have to be abolishing himself, and he cannot abolish himself. In the natural world, Yeshua would have not been considered a man of wisdom as yet because of his age, because he was still young, right? So he's not considered. And they said when he went there at 12 years old and opened up the word of God and spoke, they were like, who are you? Where have you been around? What's going on with you? They were shocked, because he had not yet the life experience. Even the day, you can't really even be called and move out until you're in your 30s in Jewish culture. And though you might not understand the Kabbalah, and there are bad things about the Kabbalah and everything, you can't even study that until you're like, I think it's 40 or 50. Because you don't have the maturity enough to separate what is good and what is bad. You don't have the maturity enough. Which is why I believe that God talks about discipleship, doesn't he? Because, and what we do is we don't disciple. We just let people on their own. So we need to have that discipleship where we are teaching and passing down. Train up a child in the way he should go. We just hope it's in the water. We just hope by just being here, things are going to happen. We need to constantly be reminded of Yeshua, who is our first love. To go back to him, to bathe in him, to eat him, to drink him. And all the knowledge and experience of the Father was revealed in him. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was God. The Word was God. And when we see how he lived, right, Yeshua, and we see how he walked, we see the collective experience and knowledge of the Father, for he was the wisdom of Yehovah. To go back and study his life is to see the wisdom and knowledge of the Father. And everything that he said and everything that he did and how he interacted and what he said and when he said it, all is the wisdom of the Father. Yes. Doesn't exclude their natural wisdom or their natural knowledge.
Right. You can't, and I think Brent said that's a very important thing to scare you away because of that. But, and at first I did too, when you would mention it, I'd be like, well, why are we listening to anybody if you don't have any belief in Yeshua? But you can't, to me, and I'm just asking you, what, when you have that collective, you have that incredible, to me, insightful and understanding of the whole base system of the Hebrew life, which is really, again, whatever it was predicated on, then you can't just throw out baby and bathwater. I mean, I understand it seems monumental, but I think there's still a, how do you reckon that?
I reckon it with supernatural and natural wisdom. Natural wisdom coming through study. They know this word means this. They connect this word to that word, this word, this word, and they see it. The difference is, and we saw it in prophecy, is that right now there's a veil. And Yehovah put the veil in front of them, right? So in reality, when that veil is removed, they will then start to see things differently and then understand what's going on through the Messiah's viewpoint. So you can't deny natural wisdom. We don't just sit, look at people who have natural wisdom. You know, if someone passed out with a heart attack and I said, you know, they started doing CPR, excuse me, is this supernatural wisdom that you're doing or not? You know, I would want someone to use their natural wisdom, and I appreciate their natural wisdom. You know, you don't sit back and say, well, let me just pray first and see what God. Okay, the heart stopped, and if you know CPR, do it. Where maybe a lot of us don't have that. So I view them as men who have wisdom but with a blinder on, and they might even be used of God in showing wisdom, but they can't see the Messiah, which they can't really then have the fullness, but it could come, or maybe it came for some, because we do know that some have accepted the Messiah but keep it under wraps for the simple reason it's just a really hard road to toe, whether you agree with that or not. We also know that we are very choosy who we witness to and who we impart some stuff to, because we're still wimps in some occasions with people. Do you know what I'm saying? Sometimes we don't decide to use the fight. Do you know what I'm saying? We'll just nod our head and continue on. But we're not going to start anything. So I just rectify that. You don't throw everything out because it's
right,
wisdom and knowledge. But here's the thing to me. When I read them, and even if Yehovah has given them hidden wisdom that they don't even know revealed, because I have the Messiah, when I have the Messiah and read it, there's things that pull out to me that they never even knew that they were writing. So actually, Yehovah can pull that out, and I can say, wow. And then I think to myself, why don't they see that? And they don't see it because their eyes are blinded. Yours are open, and you're seeing through the eyes of the Messiah, and the Messiah can pull those things out. So, you know, he'll use whatever he needs to use and whomever he wants to use in order for that truth to come. So when we see how he lived, Yeshua, and walked, then that wisdom we know is from him. So we are then in the Messiah, and the Messiah is in us. So here's the analogy. Here's a very simple path. If we follow him and walk like he walked, he will manifest this gift, for Messiah is the wisdom of Yehovah, and we are the body of the Messiah. So what would be missing of the lack of manifestation? The lack of walking and following him. Like him. That's what's missing. Now remember, he changed your what? Heart, because that's something he has to do. But what stops you from walking like him and following him? Your mind. And where does the enemy take up residence? In your mind. And you have to start bringing every thought that's trying to raise itself against the knowledge of God and bring it down. And every thought into captivity. And when that happens, you start doing what? Walking and being obedient. And when you start walking and being obedient, what will happen? The manifestation gifts will be in operation in your life. And he didn't say, I give it to a certain person. What he said, to one and then to another, which means at any given time, because you are the body of the Messiah or part of the body of the Messiah, if wisdom is needed and someone needs it and you're the only one there, you can ask God and he will give you the wisdom. If knowledge is needed, it can be there. If healing is needed, it can be there. You don't have to run to a faith healer. You don't have to run to a wise man who has gray hair. What you need to do is learn to surrender yourself. But you can't surrender yourself if you're not walking and following him. Don't expect those to be in operation. Right? So don't throw it out and say, well, then I will never do it. No, just strive to be like him. Seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and then all these things will be added unto you. Thirst after righteousness. Want him. Go back to your first love. This is the 50 days of consecration. This should be a time when the gifts of the Spirit will be in operation throughout this place. Someone needs wisdom, it will be there. Someone needs not, it will be there. Someone needs healing, it will be there. You'll find the reason is because we're surrendering. And when we surrender, we open up a veil. He will manifest this gift, for Messiah is the wisdom of Yehovah, and we are his body. So let's look at Exodus chapter 31, verses 2 through 3, which gives us an example of this wisdom in Torah. Because when God comes and gives the blueprints for the tabernacle, did any of them ever build a tabernacle? No. Right? And what does Yehovah do? He calls upon the sons of Uri, and look what it says in verse 3. And I have what? Filled him with the Spirit of Yehovah. Filled him. I didn't lay on him. Right? I filled him, which means I went right into him. Right? And I was in him. And I filled him. Now, he filled him because he accepted him as the Messiah, because it was the same rock and the same Spirit that brought them out of Egypt. He stood before the Torah and said, we will. So now you will be our God. Right? And we will be your children. So they've had a salvation experience, right? The blood applied on the doorpost. They came through a baptism, a mikvah, through the Red Sea. So they're born again. The Spirit of God's about ready to fill them at Mount Sinai, right? And we see that it happens. And he's filled with the Spirit of God and what? In wisdom and in understanding and in knowledge and in all manner of workmanship, which means he might have had some natural understanding, but you don't have and need natural understanding when you're building the house of Yehovah. You need his understanding, his way of doing things. And so that's why the Spirit of God had to come in and give what? The wisdom of God, the wisdom and knowledge of God, the purpose of God, the craftsmanship of God. Because we already know he's a builder, because when he came and wrapped himself in humanity, what was his profession? A carpenter. We already know he's a builder. Can you imagine as his father, Joseph, is trying to teach him about building, he's kind of like chuckling. Mm-hmm. Oh, really? Do that? Oh, okay. When you look at the entire book of Proverbs, how many enjoy the book of Proverbs? The book of Proverbs is all about this gift of wisdom, which is intimately tied to understanding. Let me give you a couple examples. For Yehovah gives wisdom. From his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. He stores up common sense for the upright, is a shield to those whose conduct is blameless. Proverbs 14:33. Wisdom is at rest in a person with discernment, but in fools, it has to call attention to itself. If Yeshua is the Messiah, are you saying something? Are you just laughing? Okay. If Yeshua is the Messiah, and he is the word of Yehovah, and the word is from the beginning, then it follows that all the gifts of Yehovah come from the same source. Yehovah, the word, Yeshua. All right, let's look at the gift of wisdom. The gift of knowledge. The gift of knowledge in Hebrew, da'at, which is a knowledge from an experience. A knowledge from an experience. Now remember, there's a contrast between the knowledge from Yehovah and gnosis, which is sought out by men. Men want knowledge. And knowledge has its place, but we want the knowledge of Yehovah. So, if you have that, let's look at wisdom. Wisdom is collective knowledge through a lifetime of experience. And since this is a manifestation gift, we know that it is a knowledge not previously learned or taught. Both the gift of wisdom and the gift of knowledge is what you should have after years of experience and gaining great knowledge and wisdom. But you have bypassed that, okay? So this wisdom and knowledge of the world is gained by our limited physical existence. You can only gain as much knowledge as you can take in, right? There's no way, unless you're a genius, and we have geniuses here. There's no way you can go to the Library of Congress and read all that and gain all that and come back and tell me everything was in the book. You can't do it, right? First of all, you don't have the length of life, nor the time, unless you're just, you know, kind of a hippie hanging around. I think I'll read some stuff. Everything we know about a particular issue or event in life is based upon our lifetime experience. So therefore, by nature, it is limited. It's limited. Which is why professionals, for instance, like Sister Gail with speech pathology, knows what she knows according to what she has studied and according to what she has life experience. But there could be another life experience that comes that she has not familiar with, so she would have to gain that knowledge, right? Because her just having the title speech pathologist doesn't give her all wisdom and knowledge about all things. And people change. And things change. And the way they think things need to be done changes. Correct? Because we all know some things that we thought worked, later on we find out doesn't work. How many remember when you screamed and yelled at your children, you thought it worked and then it didn't work, so you tried something different. Right? You went from screaming to spanking to timeout. To here's $20 for a taxi. Live your life. Shalom to you. Something has to work. I don't know what will. Everything we know about a particular issue is because you've learned it. It's an event in life. And you have some experience in it. Now, the knowledge that comes from above is founded upon our Creator's eternal existence. This is what I want you to get. Because you are in him and he is in you, you have all the experience and knowledge and wisdom of the Creator. That is a wow. The first occurrence we find in Genesis 2:9, out of the ground, Yehovah God calls to grow every tree pleasing in appearance and good for food, including the tree of life in the middle of the garden and the what? The tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And because of our ancestors, we inherit this kind of knowledge because our ancestors decided that the tree of knowledge of good and evil they wanted to take of instead of just understanding that the tree of life is his knowledge and his wisdom and he knows best. When you ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you get to choose what you think is good and bad. We're still eating from it. We all know from our limited experience that many people, sometimes even ourselves, deny Yehovah or judge him based solely on our lifetime experiences. They had a very short time when he said, don't eat from this tree because you will surely die. They don't have a life experience to understand what that really truly meant. And so what did they do? In their own wisdom and their own knowledge, they ate from it. Our children do the same thing. They make decisions based on their very limited experience and life experience. And what do? We try to raise our hands. Stop. We have life. We know the path you're going down is not good. What you're doing is not going to be good for you. But you did it. And that's the point. The point is I now have life experience. The Creator knows the life from beginning to end. This is what we have to realize. He who lives in you knows beginning to end. What do you know? You only know, I only know, on 57 years, I only know 57 years of life. Which sounds like a lot, but when you look at someone who's 105, that's not a lot. That means they have half more of my life experience. Right? So the Creator who is in me and I am in him, if I yield to him, if I follow him and walk in his ways, I have access to his knowledge, and his knowledge is from beginning to the end and from the end back to the beginning. There are no limitations on the knowledge that I can give to you. When I walk in and my mother asks me a question, I can say, faith. I don't have a life experience to say that. But I have him in me that has that life experience. You understand? He lived it. From the very beginning of time, he was slain at the foundations of the earth, which means he already lived it. His decisions and responses, please get this. Did you want to say something? Were you amening? Or were you saying hello? Or did you want to say something? I ignored you completely. Of a mustard seed? You can move a mountain? Yeah. Now look at this. I don't know if I have it up here. His decisions, I probably should have because it's really good. His decisions and responses are based upon seeing and knowing the end of time from the beginning of time as we know it. His decisions and responses. This word is because he already knew from beginning to end and end from beginning. That's why this is wisdom. That's why you cannot count on your life experience. Well, I've lived a long life, and they're 30. You've talked to the child, well, I've had a lot of going on in my life. Yeah, but you're 20. You don't know a squat. Talk about wisdom and knowledge. Look, all wrapped up from beginning to end. That's why we should be looking at it. There are treasures hidden. It's sweeter than a honeycomb. It's water coming from a rock. I mean, there's such things in here, wisdom and knowledge, because in here is from beginning to end. When he gives us that gifts, or that gift of wisdom, or that gift of knowledge, he has given us his collective knowledge from all eternity. Gail's a speech pathologist. If she was around people who had so much more wisdom and so much on speech pathology, she might want to sit and, ask them questions and, right, gain knowledge from them. He's been around, have always been, was and is, and is to come, went from beginning to end, knows everything, your life, my life, everyone else's life, knows every society, knows every century, and it's all wrapped up in here in knowledge and wisdom to live a powerful life. Why are we not picking his brain, if you want to say that? Why are we not saying, oh, I want to know what you know. I want to understand what you understand. And if at one moment that gift of knowledge comes out, that gift of wisdom, you don't have to boast in it because you don't have the experience or the knowledge. You have to say it's him. That's why I went to the bedroom and just did my homework, because there was nothing that I didn't know what I said. There's nothing in me. The Spirit of Yehovah has the ability to reveal something to someone outside of themselves and their own personal study or research. You can stop tonight and quit your job and go and research until you're 150, and you won't know everything that he knows. Especially if your internet goes down. Or Google goes out of business. You won't know anything. You have to go back to the books. How many? Oh, Lord, we have to go back to books. But if the word of Yehovah is Yehovah, then that eternal knowledge and wisdom of Yehovah can be and is revealed in his word. So even what that means, even before the gift of manifestation of wisdom or knowledge, that gift is here. All wisdom is here. All knowledge is here. So it can be given to you in a supernatural way by the Ruach HaKodesh, or you could look for it, and he can give it to you right there in every area of your life. And we tell people, the answers are in here. Study it. But we don't really do it. Yes. Yeah. Right. It could be the wisdom, it could be the knowledge, it's also where you're at. Sometimes we have read things that we're not ready to eat, and then sometimes when we read it, we're ready to eat, and our eyes are open, and we're like, oh, I can eat this now. You know, it's sometimes he's not, and I know he wants us to have everything, but you know, as powerful as he is, he's also kind, and he knows, because he knows you're in from back to the beginning, he knows what you need, when you need it, and when you can handle it. And so there could be some veils, and until you are ready for it, then the veil's not released. And sometimes after years and years and years and years, then all of a sudden, and you're like, well, where'd that come from? But it's always been there. The difference is who's seeing it. And I don't mean someone different, I mean your own eyes. Experience can change us too. Life experience, can we start seeing things differently? You know what I'm saying? So those who perish for a lack of da'at are directly connected to their actually rejection of the Torah. So look, my people are destroyed for want of knowledge. Because you rejected knowledge, I will also reject you as Cohen for me. Because you forgot the Torah of your God, I will also forget your children. Get it. He's not talking about you lack knowledge of the world and you rejected worldly knowledge. He's saying you rejected the knowledge that is eternal, that he knows from the beginning and the end. Who in the world would reject knowledge from someone you know knows more? That's what Hosea 4:6 is saying. And that applies to us, because how many times have we read things and we said, oh, I'll eat whatever I want to eat. I'll do whatever I want to do. And still say, I love you, Lord. And we try to figure it out. And that's what he's saying. You will perish. Not that he wants you to perish. It's not like he's waiting for you to. The purpose, this is not a judgment that he's bringing to you. What he's saying is, you will perish because you forgot the Torah. And I will also forget your children, which means he's not necessarily forgetting the children, but you have set them up where they are forgotten. It's not a punishment like I'll forget your children. What he's saying is the way you're raising your child and the way that you have forgotten the Torah and the way that you come against knowledge and you're going to be rejected, my people are destroyed. And if you destroy you, who do you destroy? Your children. And if you are destroyed, you have no children. That's why your children are forgotten. That's impactive. That my whole purpose of life now is to make sure that the legacy is left for the children and the grandchildren. And it's not hard, it's not too late to start, but you just have to, you know, sometimes it's not too late to start, but it's a fight. You can teach an old dog new tricks, but it's not as easy as it was when they were a puppy. Do you know what I'm saying? So don't, oh, it's over, I can't, no. You still strive, you pick up and you say, God, forgive me and help me. And then you pick up and you start delivering that word and speaking that truth, and you can change, because a wife can sanctify a husband and a husband can sanctify a wife, but not just because you're sanctified, but because you're living it and you're able to stand forth and something happens. I don't want my children forgotten, nor the grandchildren forgotten. So the only way I can stop that generational curse is to start gaining knowledge and accepting that knowledge And then if I'm living, then my children live. And still Yehovah's responsibility to get them, but at least I give him living children, not dead children. The context here does not suggest that his people are rejecting worldly knowledge, but rather his knowledge. So when he says, don't eat unclean, we should not eat unclean. If he says, forsake not the assembly, you don't forsake the assembly. If he says, Sabbath days, weekly, yearly, festivals, then we do them. If he says, speak truth, we speak truth. If he says, to forgive, we forgive. His knowledge, not yours. But we end up rejecting his knowledge. Maybe because some man told us to reject it. Or a belief system or a doctrine told us. But you stand before Yehovah your own self with the word of God judging you your own self. There is nothing that hurts the heart of any father more than to see his children reject or fail to appreciate a gift. You understand that naturally. So you must understand what he feels naturally also. Exodus 35:31. Let me wrap this up real quick. He has filled him with the spirit of Yehovah, with wisdom and understanding and knowledge concerning every kind of workmanship. 2 Chronicles 1:10. So now, give me wisdom and knowledge so that I will be able to lead this people, for who is equal to judging this great people of yours? I need your wisdom. You need wisdom? Ask for wisdom about your husband. Ask about wisdom for your wife. Ask about wisdom for your children or your job. Don't just think it's going to happen. Ask. How should I pray? When should I pray? What should I do? Ask. Because if you ask, in the book of Yaakov, what does it say? If you ask, he will do what with it? He will give it to you liberally. You lack wisdom because you don't ask, because you keep on relying on Yahweh changing things without you. And maybe he's waiting on you to put into practice his wisdom. Right? His wisdom says, take your portion and bring it to me and I will multiply it. We sit back and say, God, just to supply my need. But the wisdom is that you follow through with the word of God and that happens. We just want it easy. Lord, I have this problem. Can you fix it? Lord, there's my wife. Can you fix her? Lord, there's my husband. What are you going to do with him? Take him if you can't fix him. Lord, help me. What are you going to do with my children? Lord, come. What are you going to do? Ask God. He's in you. You're in him. All wisdom is in you. Pray, seek. What do you want me to do? What do you want me to say? When do you want me to say it? You'll be surprised that when you're having a conversation, something will come up, and that's the gift of wisdom, the gift of knowledge to speak it. And it could be the thing that changes everything. Because it's really not you speaking, it's him speaking it. Pray every morning, whatever situation you need. Father, I need the wisdom on this. I need to be able to speak. And maybe the wisdom is not speaking. Maybe he will say, be quiet. And you're saying, hold on a minute. I got something to say. But the wisdom is silence. Right? Sometimes even while I'm preaching or I've heard people preach or teach, there's something that comes like Sister Cecilia would say, and you're like, oh, and it hits you. You're like, that's for me. That's mine. Something clicks. Something comes from a particular time or place. He gives this gift as he wills. Some of you know Linda Golombeski. I use this story a lot of times. Linda Golombeski, she was a very large woman, very, very large woman, had a really problem with her weight. I'm talking very large. And one time, she's passed and in heaven now, but one time we were having an altar call. And I don't know anything about, you know, I struggle with my own weight. Anyone agree with me? How many like food like me? How many like Reese's eggs and potato chips and... That's of the devil, you people. But, I mean, the Spirit of God was moving. We can all testify it was there. And she came up, and the Lord spoke to me and said to her, if you will do this, and you'll do this, and you will do this, then the weight, actually, I said, the fat will come off like butter in a skillet. Now that's stepping out, because you're like, and I was like, Lord, I can't believe I said that. Because I said, if you do this and this and this, you know what? She started doing those things. And within the year, she had dropped hundreds of pounds. Just by doing what the Lord said. Not me. Not me. I just said it. This is what. And you know what? It doesn't mean now I have a ministry for all large people. What it means is, for that moment, at that time, she needed it, and therefore she was willing to receive it, and God used me to give it to her. I'm not a physical, you know, whatever. I don't know diet or whatever, and that was even before we began to do Torah. And I spoke those things, and it was just melting off like butter, like someone to New Jersey, like butter in a skillet. All I'm saying is, I say that to say, if we're available, he can use us, even in just those regular things. Not as we will, but as he wills. And that's the critical aspect of the Ruach. Very quickly, the very definition of spirit, I know I'm long, but I got 5 minutes. The very definition of spirit as energy, we talked about it, brings us to understand that all followers of Yeshua are given all the word of Yehovah when they believe on him whom he has sent. That reality is reflected in what is called, and we talked about it before, potential energy. All of you are sitting here with potential energy, right? But when we follow the Great Commission and teach that same word to all nations, this potential energy becomes kinetic energy and is followed by miracles and manifestations. It doesn't become kinetic until you start putting some operation to it, right? So you're sitting there and you're thinking to yourself, oh, I want to clean the house. That's potential. But it doesn't become kinetic until you do what? Till you hear the vacuum starting to run, and not someone else running it, but you get up, and that potential energy has now turned into kinetic energy, and you're getting something done. You're becoming productive. So let me close with this scripture. Acts 17:28. For in him we live and move and have our being, or and exist. And did you know that word move is the Greek for kino or kinetic. In him we live, we have potential in him, and when we move, it turns into kinetic, and it causes us to have our being or exist. Even today, if you're feeling pains and this pain, what will the doctor tell you to do? Move. Move. A stationary muscle and bones will become what? More stationary. You have to get up and move. This hurts. Well, move it. It hurts. I know. Move it. Now I can tell you. Have surgery. What are you supposed to do? Move it. No, really, you're supposed to move it. 5 months from now? No, right now. After surgery, move it. And when they move it, what do? You want to slap them? You want to hurt them? But if you don't make it kinetic, we become paralyzed. You know how you become cold? Because you're not moving in him. As some of the poets among you have said, we are actually his children. The application of his word in our lives through the Spirit of Yehovah speaks of the most subtle smell sometimes, or the breath to the strongest manifestation of wind upon the earth. Sometimes it can just be very subtle. Sometimes it can be very strong. Sometimes it can be a weeping. Sometimes it can be a word. Sometimes it can be a tongue. Sometimes it can be a prophecy. But the application of his word, wisdom and knowledge, where is it at? In you. You know why? Because he's in you. We just have to start asking, right? And if you ask, he will give it to you. And if you don't ask, what did Solomon want? And what did he get? Wisdom. Then he started messing up at the end. However, he got what he asked for. Amen? Questions? Hallelujah. Amen. Okay, let's stand before Adonai. Did y'all get any wisdom or knowledge tonight?